Hi there, everyone. Welcome back to Objectivity with Keith, head librarian here at the Royal Society. Today, we are talking about dogs. It's one of my favourite subjects. Do you know that I have pet dogs?
I did know you had pet dogs.
Does anyone in the world not know that I have pet dogs?
You have two?
I do.
You do.
But we're not going to talk about my dogs. Here's a picture of them. We're not going to talk about my dogs. We're going to talk about some famous, extra-talented dogs, and we're going to start off with really famous dogs, because when you think of science and you think of dogs, you probably think of
Pavlov's dog.
Ivan Pavlov, Nobel Prize winning, famous scientist, famously did this work on conditioning using dogs and their response to various stimuli and food. And
great physiologist.
We have some photos here that have somehow made their way into the Royal Society archives.
They were found in a university department and passed on to us.
There are lots of pictures of Pavlov himself, but we're interested in the dog ones. Let us start with this one. You can see Pavlov there in the middle with his white beard. And the caption on the back, which I'm reading for you, says, "Doctor," obviously Pavlov, "and some of his assistants in his laboratory, the temperature is about zero and it is necessary to wear fur coats. Seated in front are Profs Pavlov, Stepanov, Savich, and Dr. Gant." And obviously there's a dog. All right, so that one's good. "Institute of Experimental Medicine. Showing the new concrete suspended room with the door open and the dog in position. The switchboard is seen on the outside through which the dog may be fed or stimulated at any point on his body or in any way, and upon which the flow of saliva is measured in a manometer."
This is Professor Pavlov seated beside his favourite dog. Attachments are shown for stimulation at various points for work on conditional reflexes.
So this is not just Pavlov's dog. This is Pavlov's favourite dog.
Yeah.
So favourite that he's shaved a whole bunch of gaps in its hair so that it can have tests done on it.
Has electrodes attached, presumably. It just looks like a standard mongrel, doesn't it?
It does, but there you go. There's Pavlov's favourite dog. Isn't that nice?
So, good set of photographs?
Very good set of photographs.
Mouth-watering, would you say?
Bad boy.
Bad
dog. Let's crack on to something really interesting. Let's find Isaac Newton's talking dog.
So these are the records of meetings of scientists at the Royal Society.
So we're looking at May the 15th, 1718, and one of the key lines here is, "The president is in the chair."
So he's chairing the meeting, the president is Sir Isaac Newton.
But then the last item here in the meeting.
"A German brought a dog to the society and caused him to pronounce several words in English, French, and High Dutch, and repeated all letters of the alphabet very distinctly by pressing the dog's lips, throat, and other organs of the voice, and thereby articulating his sound." The early 18th century is a great period for science, I think, at the Royal Society. There is some good science being done, but also they weren't afraid to bring in slightly odd things. The content of the meetings was slightly circus-like. There was a flea circus at one point brought in. So I love these little kind of vignettes of things that were going on that weren't straightforwardly science, but are just kind of funny.
The next dog we want to show you, we're going to take you to another part of the building. So the magic of video editing, we can take you there right now. So Keith, we've come upstairs. One of the many, many portraits that adorns the walls at the Royal Society. Here's another one, someone called John Hunter. It looks like a lot of the others, except for one noticeable thing. An enormous dog head.
That's right. John Hunter is a surgeon and an anatomist, very, very famous one. And he's decked out as if he was an 18th century gentleman out on a country walk or a hunt, perhaps. And he has this enormous dog resting its head on his knee. It's actually a crossbreed. It's a dog wolf. Hunter bred dogs with wolves. And that is the result. But he is Hunter doing a practical experiment to see if it could be done. And the result became his pet dog.
Okay, wolf dog. All right, Keith, we're back here at Dog Central. We've got one more thing to show people. Okay. First of all, this book.
Yeah, so this is a book by one of Charles Darwin's circle, John Lubbock, who became Baron Avebury. And this is his work on the senses of animals. There are lots of interesting descriptions in here of all kinds of experiments on the very lowest of animals, insects and so on. But at the very end of the book, he begins to talk about his own dog, Van.
"I took two pieces of cardboard, about 10 inches by 3, and on one of them printed in large letters the word food, leaving the other blank. I then placed the two cards over two saucers, and in the one under the food card, put a little bit of bread and milk, which Van, after having his attention called to the card, was allowed to eat. In about 10 days, he began to distinguish between the two cards, and in about a month, he had pretty well learned to realize the difference. Now, I'm not sure. I have a few issues with this experiment.
You spotted that.
I think the people at home probably have a few issues with this. Now that we understand about how well dogs can smell and things like that.
And the visual cues they take from their owners.
These are some of the letters that were sent in to Lubbock after his book was published. These were other people saying, my dog has superpowers too.
Yeah, talented dogs out there. This is the dog who can count. So this is Duffer. A delicate Dandie Dinmont.
A Dandie Dinmont. What's interesting is this person has written after the publicity surrounding Clever Hands, the horse. There was quite a famous horse around this time called Clever Hands that could sort of count and do mathematics using its hoof. It was sort of debunked later. But this person has seen Clever Hands, they've read the book, and now they want to talk about their dog's special abilities. Duffer.
And Duffer's special abilities were rewarded by biscuits, amazingly.
It's always biscuits.
It's always biscuits. You'd do anything for a biscuit if you're a dog.
Not just a dog.
So here we have a calculation that Duffer makes. You hold up a piece of biscuit and you say, this person said, Duffer, take 3 from 4. Without hesitation, Duffer barked a decided and indignant 1.
Right.
He barks once.
So you say, what's 4 minus 3? The dog barks. It's a miracle.
Well, you're holding up the biscuit and the dog barks.
All right. I'd do long division for a biscuit. But anyway, I think it's great that we've been able to go through and learn about some of these famous dogs, from Pavlov's favorite dog, Isaac Newton's talking dog, wolf dog, Duffer, Van. Brilliant. Amazing dogs.
The full letter. So this is a paper, a very famous paper, by William Buckland, who explored this area, Kirkdale Cave, in the Vale of Pickering in Yorkshire, and found some amazing things within the cave. And we can see here...
Oh, look at that.
...illustration of Kirkdale Cave, and a geologist, maybe Buckland himself, going for it.
So they're walking into the cave. We have some kind of cross-section of the cave.
That's right, and there's a map just here of the cave system.
Oh, this is very treasure map.